Hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Menorrhagia and Menorrhagia during the perimenopausal period, how to manage, presented by Professor Patrice Lopez. My name is Anindya and I will be your moderator for today's event. Before we get started, I would like to cover a few housekeeping items so you know how to participate. You have entered this webinar into listen-only mode. That simply means that your microphone is muted, so we don't pick up any noise from your end. We do welcome and encourage to submit your text questions at the question panel in your webinar control panel. And you can enter your questions at any time, and we will save the questions, and I will help to read the questions at the end of the presentation. We are recording today's webinar and it will be accessible at www.emas-online.org. At the end of the webinar, you will receive a brief survey and we appreciate your response. Okay, so thank you for joining today and I would like to introduce you to our presenter, Professor Patrice Lopez. Hello, Professor Patrice, are we ready?
Yes, good afternoon.
Okay, so the time is yours now.
Thank you very much. So I present myself. I am Professor Patrice Lopez, working at the University of Nantes, and I have a private practice at the Polyclinic of Atlantic as an obstetrician and gynecologist. I am the president of the GEMV, is a group d'études de la ménopause et du vieillissement hormonal, is the French Menopause and Aging Society. I have no conflict of interest for this presentation. The slide shows the different issues that we'll be discussing today. We will recall the definitions. It's important to know the history of the patient and perform a clinical and gynecological exam. And for additional tests, biological and female pelvic imaging are mandatory. It's easy to remember all the diagnoses by following the FIGOS, PANCOIN, or COCA-PAFIFA classification. Regarding the management, it's important to begin as soon as possible a symptomatic treatment to enhance the quality of life. But of course, etiological treatment is the base of management. But today, I will focus at the end of this presentation on treatment of functional causes because they are more frequent at the age period. So, abnormal bleeding, uterine bleeding, is one of the most common reasons for outpatient gynecologic visits. So it is first necessary to look at the relevant definitions. Firstly, menorrhagia is a bleeding occurring between the expected menstrual period. And we use the term menorrhagia to define heavy menstrual bleeding, defined by prolonged, more than 7 days, or excessive, more than 80 millimeters of menstrual blood or more per cycle. Uterine bleeding occurring at regular intervals. Microrhagia is a Canadian term to define spotting. Next, we are going to look at the official classification of IMS, which gives the stroke is a stage of reproductive aging in women. During the perimenopausal period, included menopausal transition, it can last between 1 to 5 years. There is menstrual cycle of variable length and plus the immediate postmenopausal period, the 1 year after the last menopausal period. So during this perimenopausal period, we can observe cycles with normal hormonal balance and cycles marked by ovulation troubles with low progesterone level during the luteal phase, or even with low or high estradiol level. So abnormal uterine bleeding or heavy menstrual period are frequent. I would like to remind you of the importance of the knowledge of patient history. You need to know the family medical background and to be aware of cancers, particularly relating to genetic predisposition, like breast, ovaries, endometrium, and colon cancer. We must ask, are there cardiovascular disease in the family, and take into account the personal medical background. Is there a medical pathology like a coagulopathy? Is there a history of surgery, abdominal or pelvic surgery? What are the number of pregnancies and birth? And for a gynecologic point of view, we need to know whether or not the patient has already experienced menstrual disorders, whether or not she has taken contraception and what type, and finally, when she had her last pap smear or HPV test. Several questions need to be asked about the current condition. What are the current medication? What is the current contraceptive method used? When was the last menstrual period? What is the bleeding pattern? Did the patient have any relevant investigation performed? We need to know about the bleeding volume, and objective menstrual blood loss measurements are rarely performed except for clinical research, but the HIGAM score can improve the assessment of bleeding. So, as we can see, PBAC, the pictorial blood loss assessment chart, takes into account the number of sanitary towels and tampons and the abundance of bleeding, especially where there are blood clots or leaking of blood. However, in the opinion of the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, this offers no real benefit in the objective diagnosis of menorrhagia. So, this kind of assessment is not obligatory. The clinical exam examination is as usual. Physical examination should include assessment of body mass index, and the higher the BMI, the higher the risk of endometrial cancer. It's very important to have this notion. Breast and thyroid examination is recommended. The abdominal palpation allows us to find a pelvic tumor. Pelvic examination, including speculum findings to rule out cervical or vaginal causes. And finally, bimanual pelvic assessment must include the test of the size and contour and sensibility of uterus and could screen some ovary cysts. There are also additional tests which can be carried out. Additional exams include laboratory tests with a full blood count and iron study, the C-reactive protein test, and coagulation test must be performed even if there is no uterine cavity abnormality, because in some studies, prevalence of moderate Wilbrandt disease may be as high as 17%. Pregnancy testing and thyroid screening may also be appropriate. Ultrasonography, hysteroscopy, and endometrial sampling alone or in combination are sufficient for the diagnosis of most women with abnormal uterine bleeding. In this picture, you can see the people of Cornier, the Cornier's people, is a disposable suction piston device. It's easy to practice young endometrial sampling without anesthesia, with putting this device through the cervix and go into the uterine cavity to perform the sampling. But caution, cancer may be not detected if it is localized. Abdominal and endovaginal ultrasonography is the most important investigation, and it is the first step to identify structural abnormalities with transvaginal sonography. The measurement of thickness of the endometrium has to be less than 5 millimeters in postmenopausal period and less than 15 millimeters in perimenopausal period. It allows the detection of polyps, myoma, and, but not usually, adenomyosis. Saline contrast sonohysterography could give additional information. We don't use this technique in Nantes because we prefer to use hysteroscopy. You must know that identification of endometrial cancer in women could be based on the structural evaluation of the endometrium. This is a question for you. This slide shows a particular example of transvaginal ultrasonography in a 50-year-old woman who was referred for the management of a large necrobiotic myoma. What is your diagnosis? I saw the patient with a Watermiller-sized uterus and pain. Of course, this case is important to show you and to emphasize that in every perimenopausal woman, pregnancy has first to be eliminated because this woman have a trophoblastic disease and particularly an invasive mole, so on the uterus anatomopathology. Hysteroscopy allows to assess polyps and guide the removal procedure. It's a very simple outpatient procedure. We don't need any anesthesia, and hysteroscopy makes it possible to specify the nature of a polyp and the coexistence of other pathologies. This is an example for a trap. We saw a fibroid polyp, and at the top of the uterus, another organic lesion, which was an endometrial cancer. Metrorrhagia in the early postmenopausal period could be evaluated by hysteroscopy, and this slide shows a picture of hysteroscopy performed in a 51-year-old woman during her perimenopausal period with abnormal uterus bleeding. Ultrasonography shows atrophic endometrium with two myomas, and we saw with this hysteroscopy, atrophic endometrium and fibroids, banal fibroids. So this result gives us the choice between symptomatic treatment, waiting until the menopause has begun, or removing the myomas. MRI is always a second choice to assess adenomyosis or fibroids. Adenomyosis is a frequent misdiagnosis, and we need three criteria: junctional zone more than 12 millimeters, the ratio between maximum junctional zone and myometrial must be over than or more than 40%, and the presence of cystic spots or hemorrhagic spots. For the myoma, MRI can assess the number, the size, and the cellularity of myoma. But you must remind that magnetic resonance imaging should not be used as a first-line diagnostic tool. Since 2011, the etiology, the causes of abnormal uterine bleeding or heavy menstrual period, can be classified before treatment using the FIGO's PAL-COIN classification. This classification could separate the structural cause with the PAL, included polyps, adenomyosis, leiomyoma, and malignancy or hyperplasia of endometrium. In the second hand, there is a COIN for the functional cause of bleeding, and it includes the coagulopathy, the ovulatory dysfunction, the endometrial causes, iatrogenic causes like contraceptive, and not yet classified. As I am a fan of football or soccer for somebody, I use the COCA-PAFIFA acronym, which is very easy to remind the cause of abnormal uterine bleeding. CO for coagulopathy, Willebrand disease, or anticoagulant treatment. CA for endometrial cancer, essentially. PAF for polyp, adenomyosis, and fibroma, and HIFA for iatrogeny, hormonal treatment, for example, contraception, functional for imbalance of hormone or endometrium hypertrophy, and atlas atrophy will occur after the last menstrual period. The important question is to know how to manage bleeding during the perimenopausal period. And we must separate the first line of treatment during the investigations. We can use symptomatic medication like painkillers, of course. Tranexamic acid is an antifibrinolytic agent, and the efficacy of acid tranexamic has been proved by randomized controlled trial. The dose advised is 1 to 4 grams per day. Iron tablets must be given for patients who suffer from anemia. We will quickly go through the etiological treatment of polyps and myoma, which require specific treatment according to the number of them and their position. We will remove polyps when they are symptomatic. And if there are risk of atypia, histologic evaluation is mandatory. And we can perform this histologic evaluation by hysteroscopy, dilatation, curettage, or by hysteroscopic resection during operative hysteroscopy. For myoma, surgical treatment of myoma is driven according to the FIGO classification. Treatment should be chosen with regard to the size, number, and location of the fibroids. For example, one myoma type 0 or 1 will be removed by hysteroscopic resection. When the myomas are multiple, we can offer conservative surgery like myomectomy. It will be discussed in the perimenopausal period. Especially when a woman has an anemia before surgery, we will discuss the preoperative treatment like GnRH analogs and the selective progesterone receptor modulator as ulipristal acetate. After the preparation, hysterectomy will be performed more securely. IRM is utile to assess cellularity and to avoid morcellation without protection. Before hysterectomy, we will ask three questions and discuss with the patient about ovarian conservation. We will discuss at the age of 55 or 60 years old. The cervix preservation, it could be fine to preserve the cervix for a sexual point of view. And to discuss, it depends upon the size of the uterus, vaginal or abdominal route. All of these cases are discussed after ultrasound examination and FIGO classification. This is an example of laparoscopic treatment for a patient who wants to keep her uterus. And as you see, the remove of the myoma will be easy and the suture, the stitch, will be found at the end of the procedure. Adenomyosis is frequently underdiagnosed, and when we diagnose adenomyosis, hysterectomy is the best choice for a treatment because medical treatment is not very effective and endometrial destruction must be avoided. This is a case of radical surgery, but done by minimally invasive technique with laparoscopy hysterectomy. We had bilateral salpingectomy for the prevention of ovarian cancer. Of course, in such a case, total hysterectomy by laparotomy is performed because of the volume of and the large myomas. Let's move to the management of functional causes for abnormal uterine bleeding or heavy menstrual period. You can see in this study the causes of abnormal uterine bleeding depends on the stage of reproductive aging in women. In postmenopausal age group, we can see that 9% was endometrial carcinoma and 13.2% was endometrial hyperplasia. Endometrial polyp was not in 35.5%. And the hormone imbalance was very low, 9%, but it does occur. At the contrary, during the reproductive age group, the hormonal imbalance is 22%, no endometrial carcinoma, just 1% of endometrial hyperplasia, and an important percentage of normal menstrual pattern. In these two groups, there is a perimenopausal age group, and you see that the hormonal imbalance occurs in 45.5% of the case of abnormal uterine bleeding, 10% for polyp, just one case to 77, so 1.2% for endometrial carcinoma. We don't miss this diagnostic, of course. management of functional hormonal uterine bleeding, or heavy menstrual bleeding after the non-hormonal medical treatment we saw before, like non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, are effective. The NSAID were more effective than placebo at reducing heavy menstrual bleeding, but less effective than either tranexamic acid or the levonorgestrel intrauterine system. It's based on the study in the Cochrane database in 2007. No evidence exists of an increase in the incidence of thrombotic events associated with the use of tranexamic acid. For hormonal medical treatment, in France, we used to use progestogène in cyclic or long-acting prescription. Combined oral pill must not be started after the age of 45 because of the increase of global risk. It's important to recommend the use of the levonorgestrel intrauterine device because, as we can see on the next slide with the results of the Sambrook study, the tranexamic acid reduces the volume of heavy menstrual bleeding, one case to two. Acid mefenamic, but we can use also ibuprofen, is efficacy. Oral contraceptive is also efficace, but progestogen and the Mirena are more efficient to treat heavy menstrual bleeding and can have an additional effect with contraception during this period. GnRH agonist or ulipristal acetate is released for the treatment of myoma-related uterine bleeding. And in addition to a very rapid cessation of bleeding, SPRMs allow a decrease in myoma volume, as do gonadotropin-releasing hormone analogs. However, estradiol secretion is not blunted by ulipristal acetate. This offers new alternatives for myoma treatment, especially in women close to menopause. But we need to know the second effect and the indesirable effect, especially we have to be sure that there is no hepatic adverse effect. Even if this hepatic effect occurs, it will be very rarely. So, to summarize the treatment of the abnormal uterine bleeding, let me show you the French recommendation. In first line treatment, we can use tranexamic acid, put IUD with levonorgestrel, or use the non-inflammatory drugs. In second line, we can use progestogen as a luteal support to reduce the thickness of endometrium and to reduce the menstrual bleeding. Or it's used between days 14 to days 25 of the cycle. Or we can use as an antigonadotropes drug. For example, we use chlormadinone acetate during days 5 to day 25 a month, and to reduce the bleeding or even to have an amenorrhea. SPRM, like Ulipristal acetate, is recommended just before surgery as a 3 months treatment, and in some cases, 2 periods of 3 months spaced by 3 months free pill. The third line will be a surgery, and we can perform conservative surgery for women who want to keep their uterus, or radical surgery. It's important to remind that the uterine artery embolization have been proved as an efficacy technique for reduce uterine bleeding and as an alternative of hysterectomy. For conservative hysterectomy, we can manage the non-structural cause of metrorrhagia by endometrial ablation. There is many techniques called the second generation technique for endometrial ablation. For example, we can use radio frequency ablation device. We can use hydrothermal ablation device and the uterine balloon ablation system. And in a recent study published in 2017, we can see the efficacy of this technique because just 15.6% of women required re-intervention after endometrial ablation, and it will concern 13.9% who underwent hysterectomy and 1.8% who underwent repeat endometrial ablation. So this technique could be proposed to the patient who want to keep their uterus. Finally, radical surgery is a real efficacy technique, and hysterectomy with preservation of ovaries and with saponectomy to avoid or to reduce the risk of ovarian cancer. When we decide to do a total hysterectomy in case of HPV positive, for example, we can choose between the vaginal way or the laparoscopic way. In a study made in Nantes, the two ways have the same results. The duration of hospitalization lasts between 1 to 2 days, and now it's possible to do this surgery in a 1 day hospitalization. So, in conclusion, I can emphasize the notion of importance of the etiological diagnosis. We must know that functional causes are very frequent in the perimenopausal period, but it's important not to miss an endometrial cancer, for example. Symptomatic management of bleeding, anemia, and pain is very essential. And symptomatic treatment should always be offered as a first option. Thank you for your attention. I think I am on time. I will give you some reference, some readings, for more information, and I will finish this presentation by the information about the next 12th European Congress of Menopause and Andropause in Berlin in May 2019. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Professor Patrice, for your presentation. We have some questions here. Actually, the first one is a comment from Peter Eller. He says that UPA has not only pre-operative indications since 2015. It is possible to treat without surgery by intermittent course of treatment of myomas. Presented information are very old, not updated from 2005-2010. Okay, do you have any comment, Professor Patrice?
Yes, yes, of course, UPA can be used for long-term treatment by periods, but in a recent publication, the European Agency of Security told us that there is some side effects, especially upon hepatic disorders. Mm-hmm. And they report 24 cases of hepatic side effects need to three graft of hepatum. So it's important to know that this treatment is very important to reduce anemia, but we need to know if long-term treatment, if the benefits are really important versus the risks.
Okay. He says it is not concluded. PRAC yes. is just investigate.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Yes. Okay. So the next question is from Jarvis Malcales. I'm sorry if I spell your name wrong. The question is, what is your experience of management of HMB by fibroid with IUS LNG?
IUS?
LNG.
LNG, what does that mean?
I'm not sure. Okay, so I will repeat the question. What is your experience of managing of HMB with fibrates with IUS LNG? Mirena.
I have no experience, no.
Oh, okay. All right, so.
Because I know in France, in Tours, they begin U.S. energy to destroy myoma, but they stop their experiences because the cost and each management last too long period and need a lot of time to perform destruction of myoma by U.S. energy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. So is there any more questions from the audience? We still have a couple of minutes. Okay. Jarvis Mahales says thank you. If the audience still have any more questions, we still have time. So if you have any questions, just please type at the question section on your GoToWebinar panel. Meanwhile, do you have any more to say, Professor Patrice?
Yes, not.
Okay, let's wait for a couple seconds if there's anyone to ask any question. Okay. Nobody?
If there are another question, they can send me by email.
Uh-huh.
And could you give my email to the audience?
Okay, I will type your email address to the audience.
Yeah, yeah. So if there is burning question or after so this webinar, you can send me.
Okay, so your email, Professor Patrice's email address is patrice.lopez@chu.nantes.fr. Am I correct?
Yes, it's okay.
Okay, I will type. So if you have any questions, you can also send your email to patrice.lopez@chu.nantes.fr.
Okay.
All right. Okay, so we have one more comment from Gulafshana Khan. The last question was about using of Mireya coil with fibroid uterus, not US, from my OMA district, let me repeat. So the last another comment from Gulab Shanahan is, the last question was about use of Mireya coil with fibroid uterus, not US, from my OMA district. Mirena, sorry.
We think that for submucosa myomas or fibroids, mm-hmm. like type 0 or 1, it's important to propose a surgical remove by hysteroscopic way. It's very easy to perform if the size of the myoma is less than 4 centimeter. In other case, interstitial myoma, the IUD, the levonorgestrel IUD, could be proposed as the first line second line of treatment after symptomatic treatment.
All right. Okay. Okay. Another question from Simona Ursu. What is your recommendations for a person with heavy bleeding through fibroids and with breast cancer?
Of course, with the breast cancer, we avoid to put a levonorgestrel IUD. So we will recommend surgical treatment, conservative or radical treatment, which can involves ovarian ablation. We will discuss with the patient all these possibilities.
Okay, thank you. The next question is from Ratwan Akur. I'm sorry if I spelled the name wrong. The question is, what about the oophorectomy in case of radical hysterectomy, conserve or not the ovary?
As we are aware about the menopause hormonal treatment, it's important to avoid oophorectomy for a benign radical hysterectomy even before 55 year old. Because the lack of hormone before 50 years old is increasing the risk, like cardiovascular disease. And we know that the mortality of castration before 50 is higher than ovary conservation. So we are militant to keep the ovary, even to women more than 50 years old, for example. And the threshold for us in Nantes is around 55 years old. But we systematically remove the salpinx because the Kurman and Shi hypothesis about the origin of ovarian carcinoma.
Okay, we have another comment from Peter Eller that says fibroids are gestagen dependent IUS Mirena contains levonorgestrel. We have one more question from Hajime Oishi. Who do you give MEA or microwave endometrial ablation for perimenopausal menorrhagia?
Oh, I have very little experiences of endometrial ablation because the cost of the procedure, and we reserved the endometrial ablation with microwave, with thermal balloon, etc. For women with a poor level of health, and women for whom it's important to preserve the uterus. So we just perform endometrial ablation between 5 to 10 cases per year in a university hospital like Nantes, and it's very low use of endometrial ablation. So we think that the hormonal treatment like progestogen, levonorgestrel IUD, or endometrial or uterine surgery will be better for the future of the patient.
All right. Okay, so I think this is the last question from Ratwan Akur. What do you think about the role of the ovary even after 55 years, especially for sexual function and androgen?
Yes, it's a good question because I agree with the fact that the ovary after 55 years old continue to have estradiol secretion in a low level, but continue to have estradiol secretion and androgen secretion, which is, everybody know, a good hormone for sexual desire and sexual pleasure.
All right. So thank you so much, Professor Patrice. I guess thank that you. Concludes the presentation and the webinar. Thank you for the presentation and thank you for all the attendees for being here today. Just a quick reminder, you will receive a brief survey that pop up when I end the webinar, and we appreciate your response.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, everyone, and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you for the organization. It was well done. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Patrice. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.